Hey, thanks for tuning in to another episode of Let There Be Talk. Yeah, yeah. Today is Monday, December 21st, a couple days away from Christmas. Happy holidays, everyone. Before we get into the episode, I'm going to say this episode is brought to you by Earthquaker Devices. If you play guitar, bass, keyboards, or anything, you need some effects pedals, go to Earthquaker Devices. Make an excellent holiday gift. Tell them I sent you. You need some fuzz, some delay, some echo, reverb, whatever. They got them all. Handmade in Akron, Ohio. Also, stop by their NAMM booth if you're going to be at the NAMM show in January. I'll be there hanging out, interviewing rockers. And before we go any further, just a couple shows coming up at the end of the year here. Next Saturday, the 26th, I'll be in Fresno with Sam Tripoli and Ian Edwards. We're doing the Tower Theater. That's Saturday, December 26th, Fresno. Get your tickets. And then 28-29, I'll be at the Punchline in San Francisco headlining. Kevin Christie will be there with me. Get your tickets for that in advance, please. And then New Year's Eve, spend it with Eric Griffin and myself from the Workaholics. Mr. Montez himself will be at the San Jose Improv New Year's Eve. Okay, let's get into the guest right now. Introduce yourself, my man.
My name is Franklin Vanderbilt. Drummer, singer, songwriter. Played with Lenny Kravitz for over 7 years and many others. And yeah. Glad to be hanging out with you, my brother.
Hell yeah, dude. It's so funny. I was thinking last night, you came to my show at the factory.
How could I not?
And you got to see what it's like to go in front of a bad audience. You know, at like 1 a.m., very drunk, and how to ping pong in through in and out of that.
You know what? It's not the first time I've seen that, but I have to say the way you handled the situation was outstanding.
What sucks about that, though, is like, it's not the ideal comedy situation, so now I'm at like battle. You know, drunk girls in the front. It's about me.
Hot girls in the front.
Yeah, and they're just like, me. And they're just talking full on to their boyfriends who aren't telling them to shut up or anything. And they were all wasted. You know, they'd all been there for hours.
Yeah, it's 1 a.m.
Yeah, it's 1 a.m. Yeah.
Exactly.
And so then, you know, you get excited because you wait all night to go up. And then you're like, oh, I got to fucking fight this.
Yeah.
But, you know, you learn from that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a couple years ago, I might have been doing that, and I might have just been like, oh, fuck, and just hammered through my material to get out of there. You know, like, oh, you know, because now I'm just like, yeah, this is what it is.
Yeah.
You know, it's going to be this tonight.
Yeah. But you know what? Having said that, I enjoy watching comedians, and I'm honored to have a friendship with you, because the way I feel comedians and musicians have a lot in common, it's timing.
That's it.
And you're a musician anyway, right?
That's it.
You're a guitar player.
Yeah,
I
played music, sang, and played guitar for years.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I mean, you understand.
Yeah.
So, like, I have a love for all comedians.
Yeah.
You know, because it's a timing thing, and you got to bounce off of each other, and you got to catch things. You got to watch people. You got to listen. And, you know, so I enjoy it.
Yeah.
I love what you do. I respect what you
I'm
do.
I'm glad you enjoyed it. I walked out of there like, damn, all right, that one was for the money.
Yeah.
Some are for the money.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And you know right away, you go, this one's for the money.
Yeah.
We met, I can't even fucking believe this, but it's been almost exactly a year ago.
Yeah.
And I want to describe what I saw, because a lot of people don't... aren't going to know who you are, and like myself. So I was participating in the Bonzo Bash, and Randy Rhodes remembered, and the rehearsals were down at Mates, and there was many drummers who were going to play the Bonzo Bash, and in comes this tall, good-looking black man. You know what I mean?
Fucking right.
Yeah. And no one is paying really attention. And I was like, wow, who's that guy? You dress great. You got killer style. You get behind the kit. And I remember you did, dun, 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 dun. What's the one you did? Dun, 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 dun. The song, dun, dun, dun.
I did Wonton Song.
Wonton Song. Actually, that was the one, yeah.
Yeah.
And you get behind the kit. They kick into it. And there's what happens at these rehearsals is there's probably like 10 drummers and guitar players and bass players all there learning the stuff. And everyone stopped and turned and started watching you. And I remember it like blatantly, like, whoa, who the fuck is this guy? And they're like, oh, that guy played with Lenny Kravitz. I was like, how come he still does it, you know? But wow, what a fucking powerhouse drummer you are.
Thank you.
Let's get into a little bit of, first we'll talk Bonzo, and then we'll talk about how you got into drums. But are you a big Bonzo guy?
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. I'm a Led Zeppelin fan, you know, all day.
Yeah.
I started listening to Led Zeppelin in high school.
Right. Like everyone. Just stoner music.
Exactly.
Right.
I wasn't a stoner.
Right. Yet. I get it, but I'm just saying, you know, you go to a guy's house, they got blacklight posters and a bong, and then they throw on fucking, you know, like Levy Breaks, and you're like, whoa.
Yeah. Yeah. The first song I've ever heard was Black Dog.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
then I heard Communication Breakdown, and I said, what is this?
Yeah.
But here's what's funny. I immediately understood it because, keep in mind, I'm from Chicago, Illinois.
Right.
Well, let me formally introduce myself.
Yep.
For those who do not know who I am, my name is Franklin Vanderbilt. I'm a drummer, singer-songwriter, played with Lenny Kravitz for over 7 years, and I am originally from Chicago. I now live in New York City and L.A. I lived in L.A. for 12 years. But I just moved to New York this summer and loving the hell out of it.
Yeah.
But anyway, coming from Chicago, it sounded like blues with the amplifiers turned way up.
Of course. And this is what it was.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So more research I did on Led Zeppelin. I said, oh, okay. Their influences are from Chicago. Howlin' Wolf.
Yep.
Muddy Waters.
Buddy
Guy. John Lee Hooker. Buddy Guy. Yeah. I said, no wonder I like this shit.
Yeah.
No wonder.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there you go.
Now, you grew up in Chicago. How old are you?
I'm 37.
37. I'm going to be 50 here pretty soon. You're younger than me.
You look 40.
Yeah. Yeah. I wish I did. If I shaved the mustache, I might look 48. You know? I remember talking to you about this. Was it your parents that were playing rock around the house? How'd you get into rock music? Because, you know, in Chicago, like your era might have been hip hop because you're like way younger and that was a big hip hop era.
Yeah. And that is a good question. There's two parts to that answer.
Yeah.
Well, first of all, I received my first Ludwig drum kit, I must say, at 5 years old.
Five? You had a Ludwig at five?
Yeah, brand new, man.
Who got you that? Your parents?
My father and my grandfather.
Wow.
You know, so I had a damn good start, and I'm very proud of that.
So you wanted to play drums right out at five?
My father told me technically I started playing before that because I was crawling to my mother's kitchen.
Yeah.
And I would pull out pots and pans.
Yeah, just beat on
them. Just start beating on them. And, like, my father would spank my hand, and he'd say, you know, don't do that.
Yeah.
Stop pulling out your mother's pots and pans.
Yeah.
So I would cry and I'll go back and do it again. And he noticed that I wouldn't stop. So he said, all right, I think my son's going to do some music. Because prior to that.
Yeah. No, just hold up. Close. There you go.
Because prior to that, my father played the saxophone.
Oh, yeah? He was a musician.
Yeah. Yeah, he played
saxophone. What did he do for a living?
Well, now he's a minister.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Wow. But what was he doing?
But he wasn't always a minister.
Right.
But he's a minister now.
Wow.
You know, for a long time. You know?
So what did your parents do while you were growing up? Were they like blue collar?
Well, my father was always a good working man. You know, my father was a manager for these high-rise condos at the time.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
kind of like that, we're moving on up, you know?
Something like
that.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. But like, you know, growing up, we had a couple cars, and I had the things that I needed.
So you guys were upper middle class.
I want to say working family.
Right, gotcha. Working class. Yeah, your mom worked?
Upper, lower, whatever you call it. I don't know. My dad had a good job, and you know, I had what I needed growing up.
Yep.
You know, like every family, we all have some struggles at some point, but my father and mother took very much care of us.
You know? You the only child?
No, I got three sisters.
Wow.
Yeah.
Three sisters. Mm-hmm. Older?
One older, two younger.
Nice.
Mm-hmm. But, you know, my father worked quite a bit.
Yeah.
And when I turned 5, I'll never forget this day. My father and grandfather took me to a music store downtown Chicago.
Yeah.
And at the time, it was called Guitar Gallery.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, all right.
Later, I guess Guitar Center, you know, swallowed up that business.
Yeah, yeah. You know,
but it was called Guitar Gallery then.
Wow.
And I walked in, and I remember seeing a sea of Ludwig drum sets. And I pointed out an orange drum kit, and it was called the Ludwig Rocker Series. And Jim Catalano, at the time, that's still involved with Ludwig drums today, he made that particular line of drum set. So I chose that drum set.
Yeah.
I took it home, I set it up, and I'll never forget it. I started playing like it was, you know, normal. It felt natural to me.
5 years old.
At 5 years old.
Wow.
A cousin of mine just recently sent me the picture of that. And,
yeah.
And I had to stare at it for 2 hours, and I reminded myself how long I've been playing drums.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, right?
Like, I stared at it for hours, like, wow.
Now, what were you?
This long,
were you playing to like your parents listening to rock? Like my question was,
yeah, I'm getting
how
to
did
that.
You, yeah, how did you?
I'm
know
getting
it?
To
yeah.
that. Yeah. So, when I received this drum set, my grandmother bought me this radio.
Right.
It was a, you know, you remember those radios in the 80s, the big.
Oh yeah, the ghetto blasters.
The ghetto blasters.
Yeah.
I had one of those.
Yeah, so yeah. I had one Sanyo.
Yeah.
So. Yeah. Sanyo was like the shit,
exactly.
You know, back then, you know?
Exactly. So
just Beastie Boys era, man.
Exactly. So not realize what I was listening to, I would choose stations and try to cop the beat.
Yeah.
You know, I was listening to Steely Dan, Earth, Wind, and Fire, some blues songs,
yeah.
You know, whatever it was, Otis Redding. One time, I heard a Deep Purple song.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what is this? So I would try to copy it.
Yeah, yeah.
So as a matter of fact.
So just shit on the radio just to play to?
First.
Yeah.
And then when I got a little bit older, my father gave me his record collection.
Oh, badass.
Now, here's your answer. In that record collection was an assortment of jazz music, soul music, and I'll name the names. It was Isaac Hayes, David Fathead Newman.
Yeah.
Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Oh, so good.
Cream.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
There was a Zeppelin record in there.
Yep.
What else is in there?
What about that Earth, Wind, and Fire record, man? Shining Star.
Shining Star, yeah.
I can't even believe it.
I was listening to that shit as a kid, man.
Me like, too, man. I just couldn't believe how fucking great it was, you know?
Yeah, Curtis Mayfield.
Oh, yeah, Curtis. Yeah.
See, keep in mind, again, I'm from Chicago, so this music was laying around. Earth, Wind, and Fire is Chicago. Curtis Mayfield of Chicago.
Yeah, yeah.
Buddy Guy, that's Chicago.
Yeah, yeah.
So all of this music was available to me.
Yeah.
So,
it's interesting.
What else was in my-
it's interesting because what you're talking about is how I grew up too. Is like, I didn't listen to black music. I didn't listen to rock music. I didn't listen to like, you know, jazz. I just listened to music.
Right.
So one record would be, you know, Earth, Wind, and Fire. Then the next record might be the Grease soundtrack. And then or the Urban Cowboy soundtrack. And then it would be AC/DC Highway to Hell.
Yeah.
There was no rules, you know?
No, like I had an assortment of different things.
Yeah.
A lot of Isaac Hayes, Barry White.
Yeah.
TSOP, The Sounds of Philadelphia.
Oh, yeah.
You know, that kind of stuff. The Morning, Noon, and Nightlighters. All kinds of stuff.
Who's that?
It's an old group. I remember the record very well, but I can't find it right now. You know?
What are they called?
Morning, Noon, and Nightlighters. It was a kick-ass record.
Wow. Wow.
You know?
I'm a huge fan of the 70s soul.
So am I.
I can't believe how good it is, you know? Rolls Royce. I mean, I remember seeing Car Wash in the theater, And as much as I remember the music, I mean the movie, the music is what knocked me out.
Exactly.
Man. And that song, Car Wash, you know, yeah. just doom, 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 doink, you know,
yeah.
you might not ever get rich. That shit was killer, man. I couldn't believe that record, man. Yeah. And all that stuff, Lakeside, well, it's all the way live. That shit, I wanted to play bass, you know, because of Lakeside. I thought bass was where it's at, you know.
Yeah,
later, I realized bass ain't where it's at.
Exactly. Exactly.
But man, but hey, that shit.
But as a drummer, the bass player,
of course.
Mean, hey, that's my partner in crime.
It really is, man. I didn't even know that until I played music that those two went together. You just, you know what I mean? Like, the bass I was into when I was growing up was, of course, like Bootsy. You know,
yeah.
some of that early James Brown, not the really early, but the 70s early stuff, you know, and then, of course, Lakeside, like I said, man, they had that funk bass, that thump, 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 you know, later, which people grabbed like Primus and everything.
Yeah. To answer your question further.
Yep.
About how did I get into rock and roll? So as I was listening to Barry White and Gil Scott-Heron and James Brown, Isaac Hayes, all of these different types of music were available to me. The older I got, my professional career began in jazz.
Right.
I started to play professionally at 15.
Wow.
So.
Joined a jazz group in Chicago?
Yeah.
And were you guys just doing covers like at night, like bars?
Covers and originals. Actually, my first gig was at a library in Chicago.
Wow.
And I got paid $200.
Whoa.
It was no turning back. I'm 15.
Whoa, 200. That's more than you're getting now.
That's what spoiled me.
I know. Yeah.
But
somebody just said something crazy before we go on any further, which I couldn't believe. It was a buddy of mine. He said he was talking to this guy, Eric Schramm. Eric Schramm's a local guitar player that I've known in San Francisco all my life. And he told the guy, he said, you know, in the 80s, I was doing pickup gigs for $150 a night. He says, 2015, it's $150 a night.
Yeah, that's
the
problem.
It's never fucking gone up.
No.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
Like, in the 80s, $150 a night was great. But then it just never moved. And sometimes it's $100 a night.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're only getting $100 a night, and you're like, ah, it is what it is. You know, fuck.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
Anyway, go ahead, man. It just reminded me, because $200 a night when you're 15 is gold.
I know.
Man,
I know,
that's
man.
Like fucking, you know, that's Jordans and like a couple movies and records.
I was off to the races, man, when that happened. And the funny thing about it, they didn't tell me what I was going to get paid.
Oh,
I just showed up
and
played, and they gave me a white little envelope at the end of the gig. I got in my dad's car, and he picked me up, and I opened it, $200.
Yeah.
I looked at him like, whoa.
Whoa, yeah.
Anyway, so I'm playing jazz throughout high school. 18, I started listening to Zeppelin, and 19 as well. So I met someone by the name of Greg Parker.
Yeah,
which is the founder of the Chicago Blues Museum.
Wow.
And he has a history of rock and roll, you know, back in London and Europe. And he had a band in the early 80s that was on CBS called Oz.
Wow, okay.
And
Rock band?
Yeah, rock band.
Yep.
So he got me into rock and roll. And another friend of mine named Jonathan Hahn got me further into rock and roll at 19 and 20.
Yeah.
So when I was 20, I was in this blues rock band. I played in this band called Ron Prince and Hard Time.
Wow. Great name.
Oh, yeah.
Great name.
Yeah.
Great, what were you guys kind of like?
People.
Kind of like Cream or something?
Exactly. Like Cream, Hendrix. What was this other influence, I would say? And Stevie Ray Vaughan.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. You know? Is that like 80s? Because Stevie's hot. Like all of a sudden in the 80s, you know, everybody wanted to be like, da, 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 you know?
Yeah, and like the bass player in the band at the time, his name was Joe Thomas, and he played with Buddy Miles.
Oh, Buddy Miles, incredible.
Back in the day as well.
Buddy Miles, I think the Buddy Miles era of Hendrix is better than the other, you know, that New Year's Eve gig where they're playing Machine Gun and all that.
Yeah.
Billy Cox, Buddy Miles.
Right.
And my buddy saw that gig, and he also saw Hendrix before that, and he said that that was the shit.
Yeah.
I had met Buddy Miles quite a few times in his later 80s, rougher era when he was partying pretty hard.
Right.
But Buddy Miles, man.
I know stories.
Yeah. Buddy Miles is a monster, man.
I know. Yeah. I know. So, yeah. Having said that, Hendrix and the Band of Gypsies, that was some stuff that I was listening to growing up, but I didn't know the name of it. I just kept listening to it.
Yeah. Yeah.
At the time.
Machine Gun's a fucking monster tune, right?
Yeah.
When they get into that breakdown and they're doing the whoo. And then Buddy hits the drum like the Machine Gun. Bop! Bop! Yeah. It's like, wow. Right?
Yeah, exactly.
Fuck.
Exactly. So, Greg Parker and Jonathan Hahn, those two individuals are responsible for further pushing me into rock and roll.
Yeah.
And I never looked back. You know, I started playing in lots of blues bands in Chicago. So, like, hey, that's rock and roll.
Yep. Totally.
You know? So, that was my start.
Yeah.
Later on, fast forward, I moved to Vegas. Wasn't playing a whole lot of rock and roll in
Vegas. What makes you move to Vegas?
Well, someone hired me for a job, actually.
Oh, yeah? Well, yeah. A drum job?
Yeah, a drum job.
Just after you're playing at like one of the shows?
Yes, yeah.
What show was it?
Well, I was playing with the individual by the name of Ghalib Ghulab.
Ghalib Ghulab, and what is that?
Well, he's Muslim.
Yeah.
Nice guy. Actually, he changed my life by pulling me out of Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he gave me a job.
How did he find you?
Another good question.
I'm loaded with good questions.
And I'm loaded with answers.
Fucking with you, man.
So, that day, I was returning home from Michigan, as a matter of fact.
Yeah.
With this blues rock band I speak of, Ron Princeton Hard Time. And I didn't go home. I had a bad habit of not going straight home. Like, my mom would want to see me. She's like, come home when you're done.
Yeah.
I'm like, okay, mom. And then I won't show up for days, but I'll call her.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm sorry, mom. I love you.
Yeah, yeah. Rock and roll.
Exactly.
Yeah.
See?
Yeah.
So, yeah. The band leader's wife dropped me off downtown Chicago to one of my favorite clubs that I worked at frequently. So, at the time, there was a friend of mine that was around a corner at a club called The Back Room that was playing drums with this artist named Ghalib Ghulab.
Right. What a name.
Piano
huh?
player.
Yeah.
Jazz piano player. So I'm like, okay, great. I'm going around the corner. I'm going to see my friend Toby Williams. He's playing drums. So I walk in the club and, you know, a few faces I recognize and they're working. And a bass player by the name of Jimmy Allen introduced me to this guy named Ghalib Ghulab.
Right.
And he allowed me to sit in. So, you know, I played, I did my thing, and I left a club later, and he complimented my drumming at the time, and I appreciated it, and I left later. So, hour and a half later, 2 hours later, he comes around the corner, this guy, looking for me.
Yeah.
He's like, hey, are you interested in working in Vegas? You know, on some music and blah, blah, blah. And at the time, I would visualize myself living in California, believe it or not. So I said, wow, you know what? Let me give it some thought.
Yeah.
And I'll get back to you. That's what I told him.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I took 2 days to think about it. And I said, wow, maybe I can go to California on the weekends because, like, I see myself living out there one day.
Yeah.
So I'll never forget it. A couple days later, we left back on tour.
Yeah.
I called him from my hotel room in the middle of the night because I was all excited about it. And I told him, hey, I want to do it. I'll do the gig.
Yeah.
I'll do it. So,
and what was the gig? It was like playing in a casino, like nightly?
It was playing in the Caesar's Palace Casino. Caesar's Palace Casino, five nights a week.
Yeah.
$750 a week.
Wow. That's good money.
At the time.
Yeah.
At the time.
You're rich in Vegas with that because the rent's like $40 out there.
I know,
there,
10
right?
bucks. Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
You know? So at the time, it sounded good.
Yeah.
And at the time, I thought the job was going to last for a few months.
Right.
I get out there 2 weeks later. the workload doubled.
Oh.
No, that's a good thing.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And so the workload doubled and the money doubled. So I said, oh, God, wait. So, like.
Yeah.
So here
and
I am.
And where are you staying? In the hotel?
I stayed in the budget suites. Remember that place?
Oh, yeah.
I stayed at the budget suites for maybe a month or two.
Wow.
You know, it wasn't so bad. I met a lot of interesting chicks.
You get some street walkers.
Exactly. Yeah. It was kind of...
Ladies of the night.
It was kind of interesting, that area, but I had a good time.
Wow. You know? That's wild, right? You're out in Vegas. You're playing at Caesars. Exactly. You're living around hookers. What a change, right?
Making good money, you know, as a 21-year-old, mm-hmm. you know? So I said, okay. So the following month, I got my own apartment and own car, and the rest is history. So fast forward to a few years later, I moved to...
You worked that gig for a couple years?
No. Well, I've worked with quite a few others between there.
Right. You were just picking up gigs.
Exactly. But I met Chaka Khan in Vegas.
Chaka Khan?
Exactly.
Chaka Khan?
So that's how I moved out of Vegas to California. She brought me to California.
No shit?
In 2003.
She saw you play somewhere?
A friend of mine told her about me.
Right.
And I was introduced to her. And a couple months later, she hired me for a gig.
Wow.
It happened just like that.
And so you moved to LA and you start playing with Chaka Khan?
Exactly. I started working with her in 2002.
Right.
Actually, I was still living in Vegas. And then the following year, I moved to LA.
Now, what are her hits?
I Feel For You.
Yep. Ain't I Feel Nobody. For You. Yeah. Oh, that's a great one.
Yeah.
Ain't Nobody. Oh, God. She got the hits. Yeah. Yeah. Those are great songs, man.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. So, wow.
So
she's working on a new record at the time? Or are you just doing like corporates and road dates?
It was road dates.
Right.
You know, Europe and America.
Wow. That's
kind of Malaysia,
cool.
As a matter of fact.
Wow.
And Japan.
So you're out there fucking doing it up like Chaka Khan. You're playing drums.
Exactly. So back to the rock and roll.
Yep.
Actually skipped a little part. I met someone on New Year's Eve, 2001, I believe.
Before the Chaka Khan
in Las Vegas. So this guy comes up to me and I had a custom drum set made for me at the time.
Ludwig?
No, it wasn't Ludwig, actually. It was a company from Canada that went under years ago named Obulus Drums at the time. So this guy comes up to me, hey, man, I like how you're playing. You sound great, blah, blah, blah. And he said, my name is Ritchie Kotzen.
Oh, yeah, Ritchie. Oh, I didn't know you played with Ritchie.
I made 3 records with him.
Wow. Yeah. Well, he's a great friend of mine. We have the same birthday.
Yeah.
And we've known each other for 30 years.
So I meet this guy. Like, I didn't know a lot about him, but like he played in Poison. So I knew who Poison was.
Of course.
And so we exchanged information and I stayed in touch with him.
Right.
Still living in Vegas. So finally, I moved to LA working for Chaka Khan. So I call Ritchie up. Hey.
Yeah.
I live in LA. Let's play.
Yeah.
And then that was the beginning of a great musical friendship.
Wow.
I started working with Ritchie Kotzen.
What records did you play with Ritchie? What are they called?
Go Faster.
Yep.
And Return of Motherhead's Family Reunion.
Right.
And he also did a record for Japan for the Japanese animation series called Gundam, if you're familiar with Gundam. Right.
Yeah.
Gundam Soldiers of Sorrow. So I played about 5 tracks on there with Billy Sheehan.
Yeah. Now, did you do... I was on tour with the Stones, and all of a sudden, Ritchie was opening for the Stones in Tokyo. Did you do those shows with Billy Sheehan on bass? It was just out of nowhere they got these gigs.
I want to say no.
Yeah. No. Well, you would know.
No. No. I don't think I was around then. What year was that?
I think it was 04 or 06 or something like that. Went around there somewhere.
No, I didn't do those shows. Actually, I did America with Ritchie, and I did 3 records with him, and we did South America tour.
Wow, yeah.
It was me, Johnny Gripperick on bass, and J.D. DeSalvo.
Yeah, J.D. from...
Zach Wild.
Yeah.
He's a good friend of mine.
Wow, exactly. Now, you're playing with Ritchie and Chaka Khan at the same time?
For a while, and then Chaka Khan stopped.
Yeah. Why did it stop? She stopped touring?
No, she switched musical directors. And yeah. You know how that goes.
Yep. So they want to use their guys.
Exactly. So I was the first to go, actually.
Mm-hmm.
No hard feelings, because after that, and during Chaka, I was working with Stanley Clark.
Well, wow.
As well.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And then later, Stevie Wonder came.
You played with Stevie Wonder?
Yeah, in 2005.
What?
Yeah.
It's insane. Did you do a tour with him?
I did a few dates with him.
Yeah.
See, at the time, At the time, Stevie Wonder, he didn't do a lot of touring.
Yeah, I get it. He doesn't tour. Dates. He just does exactly. He'll do a corporate, then he'll do some big thing.
Yeah.
What's that like when you first meet Stevie? Did you have to audition for him?
Wow. Well, first of all, I had 2 days to learn 25 hits.
Somebody calls you up and says, you got the gig or you're going to audition for the gig?
Here's what happened. Friend of mine, a drummer and producer as well, Trevor Lawrence Jr., he couldn't make the gig or something because he was playing with Stevie then.
Right.
I guess there was something else that came up that he had to do. So he rang me and he was like, hey, man, I need you to cover for me for Stevie Wonder.
Wow.
Like, can you do it? I'm like, of course, I'll do it. And so I got all the music. It's just a shit ton of music.
Oh, obviously. God, yeah, right?
And my rehearsal was a sound check.
Oh, no shit?
Yes. At so Mandalay Bay Arena Stadium.
So you know? Go down to your like rehearsal room and learn 25 songs in 2 days. And then,
to detail as much as I could. Wow. I had to cram.
Wow.
And luckily, I was familiar with all
of
the
course,
songs.
Yeah.
I heard them, of
yeah.
course, but now I got to sit down and play them right. Play them correctly.
Wow. So you rehearse at Mandalay Bay.
Yeah.
And is Stevie there or is he up in his room?
Oh, he was there.
He was there.
And yeah, he had to check me out.
Was he going like, who's this new guy?
Exactly. Well, he was expecting me, so he had to come in and work with me and play and see what's going on.
Yeah.
You know, because he's a drummer too.
Yeah, yeah. Now, was he giving you the like, you sound beautiful, man.
Yeah.
You sound beautiful. I like the way you fucked that Superstitious up.
Just no, he was happy.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I'm glad I did it. And it was a few gigs at the time. And that was it. But the experience was awesome.
Yeah. Stevie Wonder, dude.
Yeah. Yeah. But again, like back to the rock and roll, I was still working with Ritchie at the time. I also was working on my own music as well. And it was rock.
Yeah.
And, you know, just writing songs, singing and just getting things together, working on my sound, working on my musical identity and just staying focused on the rock and roll because it just totally took me over. So,
and that's this town too. LA is really rock and roll.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. So,
I mean, you play rock, you can walk into a lot of gigs. There's not a lot of hip hop gigs or even soul groups or R&B that really tour or anything. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
It's crazy.
Exactly. And I've always been the type of drummer that likes to come in contact with my drums.
Yeah, I like to,
you know.
To me, the live gig is where the world is.
Exactly.
Studio and all that, yeah, it's fun and stuff, but live, man. Like, even last night, how horrible it felt for me. It was still like, oh, that was great.
Yeah.
I went on live, you know?
Yeah, exactly. So, working with Ritchie Kotzen, having fun, a couple years go by, 2007 hits.
Yeah.
I hire a friend for another job situation.
Yeah.
In 2007.
Like you're giving this guy a gig that you don't want to do?
Yeah. No, it was a piano player. I was a musical director
for
another band at the time.
Got ya.
So I hired a friend of mine to work with me on this particular artist at the time.
Do we know the artist? Who is it?
No, you wouldn't know.
Right, gotcha.
No, you're not going to know him.
Just something you're working on.
Yeah, something I'm working on. The piano player, his name is Don Wyatt.
Right.
So he approaches me and he asked me, hey, what are you doing these days at the time?
Yeah.
And I told him, you know, a little of this and a little of that. And he said, okay, a friend of mine is looking for a drummer.
Yeah.
He's going to call you in a couple days.
Yeah. Yeah.
That call was Lenny Kravitz.
Yeah.
So from that point.
He calls you. What does he say? Hey, this is Lenny.
He wants me to come to New York to, you know, play some grooves and meet me and all that kind of stuff.
An audition.
An audition.
Right.
So two days later, I'm gone. I'm in New York.
Yeah.
that plane ride turned into 7 years.
Wow. So you
looked back.
Let's describe this audition now. Let's get into a couple things about Lenny Kravitz. First of all, a lot of people don't know, if you really listen to the first record, unbelievable.
Yeah. Agreed.
Yeah, I'll tell you, I saw Lenny Kravitz in Germany with Guns N' Roses, Faith No More, Black Crowes.
Yeah.
This is one bill.
Mm-hmm.
And Lenny Kravitz had the second record out. But, I mean, shit like Freedom Train.
Yeah.
I'm on the Freedom Train.
Yeah.
Come on, dance on the... And the sounds...
I'm getting a kick out of you singing,
oh,
man.
Yeah,
I just love
that shit. The sound of those records with that... Dun-dun-dun-dun.
Yeah.
Dun-dun-dun-dun. Uh-huh. Dun-dun-dun-dun. That shit was so fucking great. He had that... what's that thing you hit? With the stick in it, it's like a ball and it fucking makes a sound.
A vibra slap.
Yeah. It had that vibra slap in there like Ozzy had on Crazy Train or whatever. But that one and Mr. Cab Driver.
Yeah.
And also there was a song on the second record that blew my mind. It was a ballad, man. His ballads were killer.
Yeah.
And that song, Does Anyone... No, I forget what it's
called.
Does
anybody out there even care?
Yeah. So this guy, to me, was fucking amazing, man. He had Craig Ross on guitar.
Yeah.
Awesome
player.
He had a bass player that looked like Craig Ross that was a crusher, and then the chick drummer.
Yeah.
And those two, like, it was probably a good 5 years. And then even the next record, he had the hit with I Want to Get Away, which was, you know.
Fly Away.
But he was a monster.
Yeah. And, you know, again, I'm thankful for all of the artists and my past musical experience. My past musical experiences I've had, I'm very thankful for them, because Lenny is not only rock and roll.
Right.
You know, he's rock, he's funk, he's soul, he's R&B.
Oh, yeah.
And it's a little jazzy.
First two records.
Too.
Second record is heavy, like, heavy, you know, a lot of Curtis Mayfield.
Right.
A lot of Curtis Mayfield.
Exactly. So I understand why I got hired, because, like, I don't only play rock, I play all styles of music.
So when you go out to see him, why did he make a drum change? I never heard why, because now he's got an all-chick band, I believe.
More or less, yeah.
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 But why did he tell you, like, hey, here's the deal, she's not working with me anymore, or, you know, what was it?
Reunion tour with the original drummer, Cindy Blackman.
Right.
And she's a friend of mine as well.
Right.
And I understood why that decision was made, but... I'm back playing with him. I started back in October.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Well, I didn't even fucking know that. Now, I'm not talking about you playing with him now. I'm talking about, why did he make the change then? Was he just, I think a lot of times people play with people a long time and then they need to mix it up. You know, like, why was she gone after all that long run is what I mean. And you joined.
And then I joined.
Yeah.
Why did that happen?
Yeah.
Okay, I understand the question. You know, honestly, I don't think I would ever really know the answer to that.
Yeah.
But here's what I feel that it was, because, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I love what Cindy Blackman does.
Of course.
And she's always been a fixture in that band.
Of course.
I feel that, you know, perhaps he was looking for something new.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You have a band for so long, and it gets a little bit like same.
Yeah.
You want to like challenge yourself.
So he found me.
Right. Now, when you sit down the first time, does he tell you what songs to play? Like, hey, I want you to learn, you know, Freedom Train, Let Love Rule, and whatever, and you come in, or do you just come in and start jamming?
At first, I just went in and start jamming.
Because he plays all the drums on the records.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly. I just went in to jam at first. But luckily, I knew a couple of his songs by memory.
Right.
So I was able to pull it off a bit, you know, Fly Away and a couple others.
I want to look up the name of this fucking song here.
Which one?
Hold on. I'm going to get it. Let's get the second record, because... this particular, if you don't have this second Lenny Kravitz record,
well, I have them all.
No, I'm just talking to the audience. You're just dumb, you know, because it is by far one of the most beautiful records to come out in that era, which is insane here. Let's see here. Here's the albums. He's got a greatest hit. Okay, so the records Mama said. Field of Joy.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
I enjoy playing that song.
Okay, here it is. Stand By My Woman.
Yeah.
That fucking song is... It is a classic.
It is.
What year did this record came out? It came out in 91. This song sounds like straight up... I mean, at the time, he influenced me so much. I was like a full-blown rocker. And all of a sudden, I was playing with a buddy of mine, Joey Pagliaro, who was way into Kravitz and soul rock. Like Black Crowes at the time were playing a lot of like R&B kind of rock with like Sting Me, and the second record of Black Crowes was heavy R&B. So I was turning into this R&B guy, and then I discovered Curtis Mayfield, and then Lenny Kravitz covers Kung Fu.
Yeah.
By
One of my favorites.
And that fucking blew my mind.
One of my favorites.
I hear this song, I go, what the fuck is this song? They go, oh, that's Curtis Mayfield. Of course I knew Superfly and all that. But then I get way deep into Curtis for like a year. I'm Curtis Mayfield only, you know? And this Lenny Kravitz record, man, look at the songs on here. It's crazy. Stop Dragging Around.
Yeah.
Love that one. Flowers for Zoe. I love that falsetto. Flowers for Zoe. What a fucking tune, man. You know?
And, yeah, man. Yeah.
What Are We Saying? That fucking record's great, man.
Yeah, it is.
So
it
you
is.
Go in. I'm sorry, because I just, I'm like tweaking on Kravitz for a while, because it's been all good. A while. And then I'll get back into it. All of a sudden, I'll be like, oh, fuck yeah, Lenny, you know?
Yeah.
So you go, you get to New York, you set up, he's there, and you start jamming.
Yeah.
And he's like, fuck yeah, is he? Because I met him before, man. You don't get a word in, right? It's him. You know what I mean?
Well, see, here's how it went down. Ashley flew back several times. So
he didn't say he had the gig.
Not the first time.
Right.
So I go, we hang, we play. He's like, oh, I sound great, blah, blah, blah. Had some dinner, went back home.
One time?
Yeah.
Fly home to LA?
Yeah, like, yeah.
You're just in New York for the day?
Yeah. Well, a couple days.
Yeah, so, right.
A week goes by.
Yeah.
He calls me back out there. This time, I'm playing with a different set of musicians. And I'm playing and playing.
Is Craig there?
Yes. Oh, okay. Yeah, he was there.
Yeah.
What
a gig he has, right?
Yeah.
He's been. Yeah. He never needed work again. He's just like, yeah, just wait for Kravitz to play.
Yeah.
I mean, fucking great player.
Yeah, exactly. So I went out to play. I'm jamming with, you know, the cats. I go back home. I think maybe 3 or 4 days, maybe a week or so goes by. I get a call to come back out there. So I'm like, okay, wait.
Yeah.
What the hell is going on?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Like, do I got this or what?
Are they paying for your flights and hotels?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay,
absolutely.
Just checking.
But I'm like, wait a minute. So, but like this time is for a gig.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
You know, so I play a gig.
Yeah.
Get paid.
In New York?
In New York, yes.
Where do you guys play?
Cipriani's.
And what was it, a corporate or something, or just a gig?
It was a private thing at Cipriani's.
Right.
It was really nice and fancy and
right,
cool.
Right.
So, played the gig. Nothing.
Nothing.
But wait, so yeah. I think...
The worst people skills. There's nothing worse than leaving a guy hanging. Like, sometimes I'll run into a comedian, they'll go, hey, man, I think I got something for you. I'll give you a ring, like a big comedian. And then, you're like, for days, you're like, he's got something for me. I wonder what it is. Like, are we going on the road? Or maybe he's got some movie thing or whatever. And you just, your mind go crazy.
Right.
So you play a gig, and you don't even hear if you're in still.
So I asked one of the guys, I said, hey, like, what the hell is going on here? Like, am I, like, in a drummer audition or something? He's like, actually, no. You know, it's just you that's coming out here back and forth. I said, oh, okay. All right. So I chilled and was patient. So maybe 2 or 3 weeks go by, I get this phone call in May.
Yeah.
Hey, what's up? Like from like one of the
management or something.
Management or something like, hey, how you doing?
The money people.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm like, hey, what's up? How you doing? How's it going? So, you want to play in a band?
Yeah.
And I'm like, yeah. And that day, it was funny because I was just leaving jury duty. I was in jury duty that day.
The bottom of the fucking barrel.
Exactly. So I'm walking out of the fucking court, man.
Yeah.
I'm walking out of the court and my phone rings and it's those guys. And
yeah.
Like, hey, like, you want the gig? And I'm like, yeah, of course. So like, all right, when does rehearsal start? So my first gig actually.
Yeah.
Was in Rio de Janeiro.
Whoa.
Live Earth. 2 million people on the beach.
Live in Rio, Rock in Rio or whatever?
Yeah, but like it was it wasn't Rock in Rio.
Yeah.
It was Live Aid or.
It's like a special benefit one.
Yeah. Wow. One of those huge benefit concerts. Like everyone's watching all around the world. Like the stage, like stages are all around the world.
Right. So, I remember that. Yeah.
Yeah. So it was 2007, July. We're on the Brazil stage.
Yeah.
Oh, man, that was a time of my life.
Wow. Right?
I have to be honest. I wasn't nervous because the only thing I was focused on was not screwing up.
Yeah, right.
I couldn't miss a beat.
Now, what kind of guy is Kravitz? Is he like...
Nice guy. He's awesome.
If you fuck up, is he like a whipcracker? Like, hey, man, I'm docking you like James Brown, you know? I gotcha. You ever see that scene? You know I gotcha. I got you 2 times.
No,
you ever see that where he's fining Bootsy Collins and his brother on stage while he's singing? I got you. He's all here. He's going to fine me for 25 here. I got you 2 times. Boom, boom. 25. You're like, fuck. Oh, my God.
No. No, he's an awesome guy. I mean, me personally, if I must say, I didn't do much fucking up because I take my job seriously.
Yeah.
Because like I'm driving the situation, so like, I couldn't screw up or anything like that.
Right.
Because I care about what I do.
What a fucking gig, you know? Though. Like you remember the first song you opened that Brazil show with?
What was the first song? I think we opened with. It probably was Freedom Train.
Oh man, what a song, dude.
I think it was Freedom Train.
God.
And then we played all of the hits, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
It's Always funny. On the Run and so on and so forth.
Lenny, one of the things I like about Lenny and I noticed with you is you guys dress really cool. You know, you dress great. Lenny always fuck. I mean, there was this guy Jordan in New York. He had a leather like a loft, and he made stuff called Lost Art.
Yeah,
it's the name of this guy. His name is Jordan. I forget his last name. His company is called Lost Art. And the only reason I know that was I would see Lenny wearing the most insane thing. And this guy, he got alligator skin and covered Lenny's V. An alligator.
I've seen that guitar.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's how I found out about this guy.
Yeah.
And then I when I was in New York, I seeked him out, hung out. He made me a jacket. He's one of the best leather people on the planet. And Lenny would be just covered head to toe by this guy. You got to have big Lenny money to be covered head to toe, like in multi outfits. I'd be like, look at Lenny in this goddamn Lost Art outfit, man.
Yeah.
And his guitar and everything, man. So it was, Lenny always looks great. Now, when you join the band, does Lenny get you clothes? Like, because Lenny's band is a look also.
Mm-hmm. Yes. We've received clothes,
right?
You know, in the past, and you know, some stuff I bought myself too,
right? But I'm saying it's definitely a look.
Yeah, it's a look. It's a look.
Like that last band he just had with the women and stuff. That was definitely a look, you know.
Yeah.
But when he was rolling with Craig and the drummer girl and there was like a white bass player guy, yeah, like kind
of.
Yeah, he looked like John Paul Jones a little bit. Yeah.
Yeah.
They looked like a band.
Oh yeah.
They fucking were a unit, man. I remember Lenny had like Harleys that he brought with him on tour and would ride.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe it. Yeah. I was like, this guy is living the dream, man.
Yes.
God damn.
Yeah, he's a bad mofo. That's all I'm gonna say.
Yeah. So you're playing with him again.
Yeah.
Now when did this happen?
Back in October.
He calls you up?
Yeah.
And he just says, hey man, now, is he's not going to do the girl band anymore?
Well, I don't know what's in store next year. I believe he will be touring next year. I don't know what the format is going to be.
Right.
But whatever it is, I'm just going to play the drums and do what I do.
That's incredible, you know? Right?
Yeah.
So that's why you're out in New York? Does Lenny live in New York now?
He used to.
Right.
That man lives wherever he wants to live.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, I was in Paris and just ran into him. It's a true story.
Yeah, he lives there.
That's
mostly
what he told me.
Yeah.
And I said, what are you doing out here? And he goes, yeah, I moved out here, man. Yeah. This is the shit out here. This is where you got to live. I was like, what? You know what I mean? I mean, who goes? I go to Paris. I go to the Louvre and Jim Morrison's grave. I'm out of there.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
But yeah, man, that's his hood.
That's where I ran into him.
That's where he's at.
Wow.
I am not in New York because of Lenny Kravitz.
Gotcha.
Actually, it's my own artistry and pursuing acting. That's what brought me out to New York.
Right.
The way I ended up out there is that, you know, this past summer, someone called me for some studio work.
Right.
And I flew out there to do it. And I got out there. I made the records. And like one thing led to another. It's rock music.
Yep.
And I just said, you know, I think I should stay here because, first of all, I've been going to New York for years, and I've always loved that town.
Yeah.
And
me too.
I just decided to be there, and like when I made that decision, one thing led to another.
Yeah.
You know, I started getting work here and there, and
how'd you find?
I'm in Manhattan.
How'd you find your apartment? I'm just asking that because they just went through a full-blown apartment hunt and demons and New York's so bad.
I'll tell you.
Yep.
I am aware that it is not easy to find a place there.
Yeah.
Well, I have some friends there that I've had since 2008, and they happen to own this building, and they had an apartment available, and I took it.
Wow. Now, what's your rent? Can I ask you what your rent is? I'm just curious. You know what I mean? Because it's so, like, rents are a big curiosity to me now.
24.
24 ain't bad.
It ain't bad.
New York. No. Now, you got no oven, though, you said.
I'm sorry?
You got no oven, you said.
No oven.
Yeah. Tell that story. It's hilarious. You're looking around at the pad.
My landlords told me, well, Manhattaners don't use ovens. Like, they don't cook.
Yeah.
Like, you go out to eat. And so I'm scratching my head about this. Like, wait a minute. Because, like, I'm the type of guy, if I got some time.
Yeah.
And I want to eat something in particular, I don't mind cooking it.
Yeah, right. You know, do you got a stove or just a hot pot?
I have a stove. I have a microwave.
A stove, like, with no... I've never seen a stove with no oven.
Well, it's one of those electric fancy ones.
Oh, yeah.
It's really nice.
Yeah.
It's a very nice kitchen, dishwasher, microwave, you know, the island.
Yeah, you know, I know what those are. Yeah, the four eyes, yeah.
Yeah, but electric. But it's really up to date, you know, some modern shit, but no oven.
Wow.
So, again, I was like, where's my oven?
Yeah.
You know, but now people don't do that in Manhattan.
Now, you've been there all summer.
Yeah.
You're getting ready for a fucking winter, man.
Yeah.
That's going to, like, change it up there. You got no car out there, right? You just subways?
Cabs. Subways.
Subways. Uber. Yeah, Uber.
Yeah, I keep my muscle car right here in L.A.
What car you got?
Dodge Challenger.
Oh,
SRT8.
Yeah. Oh, man. You got an SRT8?
Yeah.
Oh. What year?
2012, actually.
2012.
Yeah.
Manual.
Thanks to Lenny.
Oh, did he get it for you?
Well, he didn't get it for
me. But he paid you.
He paid me.
Is that some good money in Lenny?
I'm sorry?
Is that some good money playing with Lenny?
Well, I'm not going to complain.
Yeah.
I'm not going to complain.
Yeah, right?
I'm thankful.
Hell yeah.
I'll say.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Now, let's talk a little bit before you get out of here. I noticed when you played, you attacked the drums because I watched the Zeppelin, and you were more of a push player. You know what I mean? Like where you just, like it was rad to watch, you know, like you were there on top of it.
Thank you.
Is that your style? Because some people lay back where it's almost behind the groove. Some people are right on like a metronome and some people push and drive the machine.
Well, because I play all styles of music, I play to serve the music.
Right.
That particular night when I was playing the Bonzo Bash, I felt a lot of energy, and you know, that's one of those songs that you gotta groove it,
yeah,
but you gotta have the power and the vibe too. So I just I just put my personality into it, and I just hit it. You know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I do have the skills to adjust to whatever the music calls for.
Right, right. Because Lenny's got a lot of ballads.
Exactly. So yeah. I don't play the same way on every song. It's impossible.
Right. Of course, yeah, of course not.
You know.
But I'm just saying, when I play with different drummers, each guy that sits behind there, you go, oh, this is a different feel. And then right. you adjust if you dig the feel, or you go, oh, I don't like this feel, you know? Because it's so, every drummer is totally different because it's human body.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Now, you played Vista Lights, an incredible photo of you playing the Ludwig with the, you had Vista Lights with gold hardware.
Yeah.
Which, now, was that your idea? Because I'd never seen that. It's incredible. If people don't know what Vista Lights are, they're the ones that Bonzo used. They're the clear drums where you can see right through them.
Yes.
Was that your
yes.
idea?
Yeah.
Man, because...
And but, like, also, you know, more so Lenny as well, because Lenny is
yeah.
flashy.
He's all about the gear.
Yeah, and the look as well.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. So, yeah. He's yeah. got the killer amps always.
Oh, yeah. If you notice, they were in gold, you know,
yeah.
that year.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. I mean, still got that kit?
He's that guy, of course.
Yeah.
Of course I do. It's not going anywhere.
Yeah, that's so great.
You know?
Now, did you play on any Lenny records?
Unfortunately not.
Yeah. Like you said, because Lenny plays the drums. That's right.
Like you said earlier, you know, historically, he has played drums on his
albums. I forgot
all
about that, yeah.
Yeah. No, I haven't, but I've been fortunate enough to make all of the television and tour appearances.
Yeah, that's fucking
you know,
great,
so.
Right? Yeah. Yeah, man. Now, you're going to get into acting out in New York. What makes you want to do that?
Like I said earlier, I feel like musicians and comedians, also actors, have something in common.
Yeah.
Like, just like you have to remember lines as a musician, I got to remember lines too.
Yeah, yeah.
And you have to deliver a part. And the way you deliver that part affects how a person receives it or feel it or feel, you
yeah.
know? So I want to continue to pursue acting because it's another way to express what I already do, but without my drums.
Right, right.
You know?
Exactly.
And I enjoy the art form itself. You know.
So are you taking acting classes? Are you going out for auditions? What are you doing?
Yes, I am. Both.
Yeah.
And a year ago, I was in a show.
You were?
Yeah, I was in a show called Sex Sent Me to the ER.
What's that on?
it's on Bravo.
Oh, yeah?
Is it Bravo?
Yeah, yeah.
Or TLC, I mean.
Right.
TLC, not Bravo.
You were on a show, huh?
Yeah. I was, you know, I had a little small role as a security guard. So when I did that,
yeah,
that kind of, you know, it
got the juices going.
Yeah, it kind of kicked me off.
Yeah,
to start pursuing it more. And when I auditioned for that part a year ago, I thought I didn't get the part because I didn't hear anything back for like a month.
Right.
And then all of a sudden, I get this email saying you got the part for the security guard. So
wow!
I shot it 2 days later, and I'm like, cool.
Yeah, that's great,
I'm
right?
Keep doing this.
And then yeah. you got a check the following Friday. And
exactly.
You're like, oh, this is real.
Exactly.
This ain't music where I'm chasing down the check.
That's when it became real.
Couldn't believe it, right?
When I got paid for it,
yeah.
I said, all right,
yeah,
let's
yeah.
do it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. What,
yeah.
What I was going to ask is, oh, yeah, we met, of course, at the Bonzo Bash, but you're a comedy fan. Who do you like? You got some favorites?
Oh, of course.
Yeah.
Dave Chappelle.
Oh, yeah.
Dean Del Rey.
Wait, you saw me before last night, right? Did you see me before? Where'd you see
yes.
me? I can't remember.
Laugh Factory.
Oh, yeah, Comedy Store.
Yeah, 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 I saw you at Comedy Store.
But you came to my birthday one or whatever. Nikki Sixx and those guys were there.
Yes, but even before that, I've yeah. seen you before.
Oh, yeah. Because you were Tiffany Haddish's friend? Or
yes.
You just, oh, I got
yeah,
you.
Yeah, Tiffany's friend. And I like to go to comedy clubs in general. So
right.
like, I saw you in the lineup before, but I just never...
Right.
met you before I met you at the Bonzo Bash
yeah,
situation.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, so, yeah, I like Dave Chappelle. I'm a fan of yours. Actually, the guy I saw last night, Eric Griffin.
Oh, yeah, he's
you know?
Great, right?
I like Bobby Lee. He's hysterical.
Yeah.
I don't know what happened to her, but I think she's still around. Deborah Wilson from Mad TV.
I don't know her, but I'm sure she is still around. You
yeah,
know, a lot
she's
of those
hilarious.
Yeah, a lot of those Mad TV people are all fucking great. You
yeah,
know?
Yeah. I'm a fan of hers. Keegan-Michael Key, I think he's funny.
Oh, God, yeah. yeah.
You
got a comedy in New York, The Cellar?
I haven't visited that.
You
got to
get
yet.
Down there, man.
I'm going.
You gotta
I'm going
get down there.
I haven't had time yet, but I'm going.
Yeah.
What's the name of the lady? Lisa Lampanelli.
Oh yeah, Lisa Lampanelli. Yeah.
Yeah. She's something else.
Yeah.
I think
right.
She's hilarious as well.
Yeah, she's got a new record out, I believe. That's up for a Grammy.
Nice.
Which is fucking great, man. Yeah.
That's
so she
great.
Got nominated for a Grammy this year.
Great. A friend of mine, Tommy Davidson.
Oh, God.
Yeah, he's one of my favorites.
Yeah, I love when he does that Rambo thing. Man, he's fucking good. Rambo, come out here.
I'm not coming out, man.
Listen, he just fucking kills.
One year, some cousins came to visit me here in L.A.
Yeah.
And I took them to Jerry's Deli for a quick bite to
eat. Oh, yeah.
And I think it was a Saturday night. And so we walk in, and I'm leaving. I'm crossing the bar.
Yeah.
We're about to sit down. And then all of a sudden, I hear someone calls, you know, they call my name.
Yeah.
Hey, Franklin. I turn around. It was Tommy Davidson.
Yeah.
So he comes over and, you know, good to see you. How you doing? Blah, blah, blah. And I introduced him to my cousins.
Yeah.
And so immediately, of course, they knew.
Of course.
Who Tommy was. So,
fucking guy's king.
Yeah. Just like myself, I've always enjoyed his Sammy Davis Jr.
Oh, it's so good. He can actually do the eye.
Yeah.
It's insane.
I know.
How do you do that?
I have no fucking idea.
I know, right?
But my cousins had to ask him to do that. So he just did it right on the spot. It made their night.
Oh, man. And, that's so good.
Yeah, but he's a really great person, man, and a great comedian.
He is
killer.
Great
human being, you know.
Anybody ever tell you look like Ice Cube from the early, like, America's Most Wanted era?
Did anybody tell me what?
You look like Ice Cube?
You got to be kidding me.
I swear to God.
It's only because of the hat today.
Yeah, you're right, the hat. Yeah, that's right, because you got a hat on. Yeah, because not without the hat. Yeah,
but let me tell you this.
Yeah.
In New
York, crazy, though.
This is funny.
Yeah.
When I take the train in New York, like I usually wear my sunglasses.
Uh-huh.
I get two things on the subway.
Yep.
People call me Shaft.
Shaft.
And Isaac Hayes.
Wow. You look like early Cube on America's Most Wanted with the hat on.
Wearing a beanie, too.
Yeah. It's wild, man.
Well, that's the first.
Yeah, I swear to God, I'll show you a picture because he had the scraggly beard, back then. And God, I love that guy. Did you get into? Are you a big hip hop guy?
Absolutely.
Yeah, NWA. Absolutely. Did you see the NWA movie?
Yeah.
I did the joke about it last night.
I heard it.
God,
I don't think the room liked it.
No. That room was, those guys were pussies. That room was a bunch of holiday pussies. They were so soft. It's 1 a.m. I'm doing homeless and NWA jokes. I go, ooh.
That one didn't go over
too
well.
Yeah, it's funny.
But I was still cheering you on.
Yeah, hell yeah. Yeah. All right, man. Great to have you on. Fantastic. I love you because you're a lot like myself, where you stay positive. It's a grim business we're in, and it's a rough world, and it's big ups and downs. And whenever I see you, you're like, yeah, man, let's go out tonight. And I love that feeling, you know?
Hey, again, I can't complain. I mean, the music business has been very good to me.
Yeah.
You know,
me too.
Like, I've done this all of my life. It's the longest job I've ever had.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so
me without music, there's no radio show. There's no comedy later.
Yeah.
There's no friends that I've had all the guests on, everything. Music is my life, you know?
Exactly.
And now comedy is my life, and you put them together and it's just an insane world.
Absolutely. So I appreciate all of it, and you got to stay positive.
You do.
You know, I mean, negativity doesn't attracts positive.
It's true. It's true, know? Right? It's like we could sit here and complain all day, but why?
Yeah, but that's not my style.
I know, right? Me
totally not my style.
What? Okay, you got a Twitter?
Of course.
Yeah, what is it?
F Vanderbilt Drum.
F Vanderbilt Drum.
It's
spell
my Twitter. F Vanderbilt Drum.
Yep.
Drum.
And then you got an Instagram?
I got an Instagram. Franklin_Vanderbilt FRANKLIN_Vanderbilt VANDERBILT My website is franklinvanderbilt.com as well.
Dope. And then
the Facebook too.
I can't wait to see you with Kravitz when you come. I want to go see you play with him. You know
done.
What I mean? How great would that
done.
Be? Because I only got to see you play one fucking song, you know? And it's like, oh, I want to see more, you know?
Oh, there's lots more.
I remember because I was filming you and I sent it to Bill Burr, and he's a big drum freak and Bonzo freak. We love Bonzo. Me, him, and Tishy did an episode about Bonzo. And I said, look at this guy, man. Fucking killing it.
Thank you.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you. Well, I would love to come back and visit you when my album's done. I'm currently working on an album in New York. And
yeah, solo record, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Now, you write all the music. What's the style?
It's rock and roll.
Rock and roll.
Yeah, I like to call it rock and soul. You know, right. Rock with some soul overtones.
Yeah, hell
so,
yeah.
Like, I still got to be true to my roots as well, which was originally blues and soul.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, but I totally love to push the energy forward, and yeah, like rock and roll has taken me over, so that's where I'm going to stay.
Yeah, yeah, man. You know? It's all fucking good, yeah. Right? All right, man. Thank you so much. Thanks for tuning in, guys. See you later.